The First World War was clearly one of the defining events of the 20th century, and I think it's very important that we understand firstly the scale of the war and its impact on the societies that were involved. And I think most people would argue that it's important that we remember the men and women who died in the war, partly because they did make that choice to serve in the armed forces. In the case of Australia, all of them chose to do so. But also they, their example is one which today's defence forces follow, and I think today's defence forces feel they need to be honoured and commemorated in the same way as we now commemorate the people who served in World War One. Oh, that's undoubtedly the case, yes. And I think that reflects the particular national and cultural experiences of different countries. Not only how many of their men and women served and died in the conflict, but in particular how important the memory of the conflict has been in their political life in the years after. So yes, there are very significant differences. World War One's, I think, is relevant in today's society because it resonates with a widespread concern about the cost of war, and I think a deep interest on the part of many people in tragedy and sacrifice. I mean, we know that many of the people who go back to visit battlefields and wartime cemeteries seem to do that because they find some sense of identity and some value in positioning their own family's experiences within a much bigger narrative, be it the narrative of their particular nation or even the universal narrative of life and death. And the fact that people are now able to access online databases and to find out that that's where my great-great-grandfather served and died, I think has enabled them, families and individuals, to particularise the memory of war. And so my feeling is it's probably not that people remember the politics of the war, but they remember the lives of the individual family members who took part in the war, and that's what gives it significance to them nowadays. Well, it would depend on which kids you were speaking to, what would be the one big takeaway of World War One. I can only speak for Australia, but for Australians it would be the story of Gallipoli. But beyond that, they would remember the story of Gallipoli, particularly by the film of Gallipoli. And what they remember there, I think, is a story about young men's lives being wasted, particularly by military officers in command who were incompetent and unthinking. So in many ways, one of the dominant ways that the war is remembered is still that idea of the futility of the war and the incompetence of those who manage it. That really has very little to do with the history of the war, but it's certainly a very dominant memory of the war. I think the World War One Museum here at the Liberty Memorial is extraordinarily good. I think it has particularly succeeded in positioning the American experience of World War One within a wider international context, which often gets lost because I think many different countries tell the story of World War One within a simply nationalist narrative. And what this museum has done very effectively is to say that the American contribution was only one element of a huge multinational conflict. Americans, as you may know, sometimes are thought to have taken undue credit for victory in World War One, and other countries sometimes say, well, you arrived rather late and didn't win the war. And I think this museum has really, in a very sophisticated and nuanced way, explained the complexity of the war, both on the battlefronts and at the home fronts, and the political and cultural influences causing and shaping the war. And I think it succeeded very well in distilling from a very complex story some essential elements.